Welcome to this edition of the Fikki Chat with Chair. We're delighted to have Mr. Pranav Saitha, partner and national leader, international tax and leader in ENY, but he is also, more importantly, the chairman of the Taxation Committee in Fikki. So thank you and welcome to this very special edition on Chat with Chair. It's going to really focus on the budget. So, you know, the top of mind question to everybody is, what are your three major expectations from the budget? And if I can just link another question to that and say, what do you think that the budget 2021-22 should focus on? Over to you, Pranav.
Sure. Thank you so much, Dilipji. So, like with every budget, it's critical because that really sets the tone of how the economy probably will do in the next few months and the year to come. In this year in particular, I think the budget is going to be pretty crucial and critical given what the economy has been going through and has gone through over the last maybe 10 months. And particularly so, not just in India, but across the world, which has impacted not just the domestic economy, but also India's exports and competitiveness across the world. So we are seeing a very unprecedented time of how the economy has been behaving. The government has ended up spending a considerable amount of money on COVID-related relief measures. The collections have been extremely muted. The economy has been really not doing well would be an understatement, but struggling. We've seen the highest degrowth ever in terms of a 24% degrowth in Q1 and again a 7.5% odd degrowth in Q2. So if one were to look at this budget, I think there will be two, three key themes that one would hope to see from the budget. One is a considerable amount of fiscal stimulus, particularly to ensure a demand push and that the economy comes back very quickly from where it has been over the last 1 year. So I think that is going to be key. And I would feel to some extent that is best achieved through the multiplier effect by giving a big push to infrastructure. So if we see the infrastructure sector, typically the multiplier effect is for every rupee spent, there is a 3.25 uptick in the economy. And therefore, I would feel that that should be one key thrust area in terms of the government spending. And therefore, if the government really loosens its purse strings to some extent to spend heavily and freely on infrastructure, it is money well spent, even if that means raising the fiscal deficit. In any case, for the financial year ended 2021, I would feel the fiscal deficit is likely to be probably upwards of 6%, much more than the 3.5% that one was originally expecting. So indeed, the fiscal deficit is going to be under strain, but these are special and unprecedented circumstances. And so long as the extra money is not being spent on unproductive revenue expenses of the government, I think the government ought to be far more willing to increase the fiscal deficit, but not compromise on spending, particularly CapEx and in the infrastructure and healthcare sectors. So I would feel a major fillip should be that. Along with that, and it has to be a concerted effort to bring in more investments from the private sector as well. So we would feel that both for infrastructure investments and investments in high employment generation areas, whether it is services, manufacturing, and so on, the second thrust should be giving adequate incentives to these sectors, as for example, in terms of ensuring that investments into infrastructure get some kind of a fiscal advantage, benefit, tax incentive. At the same time, also ensuring that any increase in Make in India manufacturing, new manufacturing setups, which probably are set up not till March 23, but till March 25, get the benefit of the tax incentives that were originally envisaged for manufacturing commencing till March 23. So the second is a thrust on manufacturing, Make in India, and investments, both domestic as well as overseas, into manufacturing as well as infrastructure. And in terms of the services sector, I would feel that especially high employment generating services sector as well should be given such fiscal incentives. Finally, I would feel that India is at the cusp of a major opportunity here, both in terms of long-term demographics that we have here, the ability, entrepreneurial skill, the engineering and math skills that we have, and at the same time, in terms of the geopolitics, the opportunity of attracting more investments, industries, supply chains into India. And that's where if we give the right fillip to innovation and R&D, that mindset of bringing in the best in terms of technology abilities and enhancing therefrom will go a long way. So some thrust on R&D and innovation would go a long way in helping us achieve our long-term aspirations as a country and an economy.
I can just follow up with that. And you mentioned that giving a fillip to local manufacturing, you know, and investment in the manufacturing sector, although you talked about investment in infrastructure there. But if I were to look at investment in manufacturing, other than taking the 15% tax rate from 2023 to 2025, are there any other key tax reforms that we could do to attract foreign and domestic investments? And also, you know, what could the government, you know, do from a tax point of view on Atmanirbhar Bharat going forward? While they announced the Atmanirbhar Bharat and the PLI scheme, there's a kind of a silence or a lack of understanding whether it is 15% or, you know, 25% or, you know, 35%. What is the tax rate going to be applicable to them, especially if they're not greenfield projects? So, you know, what do you think the government should do?
Yeah, so on the manufacturing side, I think some amount of clarity in respect of some of these measures where they seem to be restricting the meaning of manufacturing in many ways, whether it is software, whether it is mining, whether it is power. So some of these aspects, clarifications would help apart from extending the date till March 25. What we do also feel is that some amount of clarity on the MAT provisions there will be extremely helpful, because the way the provisions are set, some of it can impact clarity as well as the ability of industry to be able to take full advantage of it. And finally, I do feel that while the 15% rate is absolutely fine, one should probably extend it to also services, especially in certain parts of the services sector, to help employment generation. And what I do feel is that a considerable amount of fillip to R&D and innovation could also go a long way in furthering the cause of Atmanirbhar Bharat and having a self-reliant India, and in India which is technologically at the cutting edge of the best in terms of state-of-the-art technology across the world. And if we do some of these things right, apart from bringing in the infrastructure and cost competitiveness advantages that India really badly needs, that would go a long way in helping Atmanirbhar Bharat as well as Make in India. There are certain areas, of course, like labor reforms and land reforms, which are a little more difficult for various political and other reasons to implement. But some of these low-hanging fruit themselves could considerably help India in making itself more competitive, productive, efficient, and helping our cause in terms of being able to attract much of the investment that some of the other neighboring countries could probably lose out, particularly because people across the world, multinationals, do want to de-risk and want to spread their eggs in many more baskets than earlier.
So, you know, just to take that thought a bit forward before I come to the other thing, you know, there is a thing about having, you know, a tax rate. The second is a stable tax policy. And the third is the way you actually implement the tax policy on the ground, you know. So what do you think, what approaches and steps in your view should be taken by the government so that there is some predictability in the system and there's some standardization here and to promote a stable tax policy at the same time, you know, make it easy to comply with and, you know, reduce the number of, you know, the litigation and the you know, the whole questioning expenditures, etc., going forward.
So, absolutely. I think the government has been putting in considerable effort, whether it is in terms of faceless assessments, whether it is in terms of citizens' tax charter and so on. What we really need to see is how these pan out. But more importantly, what I do feel also is that if there is quick clarity issued on some of the compliance matters and some of the ambiguous issues that confront corporate India, it could go a long way in improving the investment and business environment in the country. Whether that is in terms of issuing quick clarifications, whether that is in terms of issuing circulars, revenue clarifications of how certain provisions should be introduced. If we look at TDS and TCS provisions, for example, that were recently introduced, there were considerable amount of confusion, lack of clarity for quite some time. If we look at equalization levy and the way it was introduced, again, a lot of clarity was lacking. So in some of these matters, as soon as legislation is introduced, some form of Q&A clarification will go a long way in improving matters. Second, I think a considerable amount of ease of compliances is called for in terms of some of the filings. And third, I think a decriminalization, which also is an effort of the government, because many a times the kind of authority being exercised brings so much of risk and fear in the minds of businessmen that is not very helpful in terms of ease of doing business. Yes, also the accountability that we are talking about from the revenue side would go a long way. And in many cases, we see such high-pitched assessments, which ultimately do not stand, but during the process of that litigation create so much inconvenience, so much cash flow issues, and so much of difficulty for a businessman to be able to operate is something that I think is worth addressing immediately. Whether it is in terms of tax deduction at source, tax collection at source, some provisions relating to restructuring, especially in COVID times, we have seen any business restructuring, there are sometimes conditions which are so onerous and not allowing consolidations, not allowing separations and carve-outs and quick exits are what probably need to be addressed. Some of those are contained in the representations that we have made as FICCI to the government. And looking at those with some open mind and with speed might go a long way in improving the investment and business environment in the country.
So, you know, you talked about demand initially and talked about investment in infrastructure because of the, you know, the rate of return or the multiplier effect of infrastructure. But there is also a thing that, you know, can you look at, normally a reduction or a temporary reduction in the personal income tax rates, right? And there are two sides to this story. Should there be a reduction for a temporary basis in the personal income tax rates? And the other side is that, you know, no one will actually at this point oppose a COVID tax. So, you know, what is your view on personal taxation and any additional taxation in this budget?
Well, that's a very loaded question and a very important one occupying a lot of people today. Yes, there is, in a year in which collections have been so muted and fiscal deficit is out of control, there would be a natural urge to want to increase collections in any form and shape. I think that should be really refrained from. One should keep in mind that this shortfall in revenue collections is because of a special pain that the economy and the entire business and taxpayer community has been going through. So it is every citizen, every business is sharing in the government's pain. It is not that the revenue shortfall in revenue collections is at a time when the economy and everyone is really flush with funds. So that needs to be borne in mind. The government probably will keep this in mind and therefore not impose any new taxes, hopefully, in this budget. The idea should be to ensure bringing in some form of stability and continuity in the tax regime, recognizing that this is a one-time special event and the fiscal deficit probably is something that can be lived with, rather than trying to increase taxes. In India, we generally have also seen that nothing is temporary. And in any case, at this point of time, even a temporary tax will be like the last straw on the camel's back. I do not think that the economy, taxpayers, or the business community deserves a new tax. Probably they deserve some support at this point of time. So I would much rather feel that the government will go in favor of stability, continuity, and predictability of the tax regime, and look at this as one special year where the collections are short and the fiscal deficit is higher. In terms of increasing taxes, therefore, I would feel that is something that the government should refrain from. For the rich and the very rich, taxes have been very recently increased quite a bit. And therefore, while there might be some urge to increase taxes at the very highest level, I would feel that the rates there have already reached 43%, and probably any further increase might actually be counterproductive. Rather, it has been seen that the effort to win the trust, confidence of the taxpayer and give him the comfort that these rates are here to stay would go a long way in developing that particular comfort. Also, if I look at it from the point of view of reducing tax rates, I do not see much room right now for a reduction in the tax rate. But at best, what probably can be expected is for individuals who are within a certain range of income, at the lower ranges of income, if there can be some relief in order to give a demand push. But other than some very small relief at those lower rates of taxes, I do not see right now a big reduction in tax rate feasible at this point of time, given all constraints that the fiscal deficit has thrown up.
Thank you for that. You know, I just want to just expand on a point that you mentioned earlier. You see, you talked about the fiscal deficit being around 6%, right? And we have the FRBM Act, okay? Now, you think it's a good time now to review that, because, you know, we'll be bound by coming back to the roadmap. So should the deviation be for 2 years, 3 years, or, you know, what should be? Because, you know, we don't see the economy recovering, you know, some sectors of the economy recovering to that extent, you know, even in the next year. So would this be a good time to do it, or they should delink the two issues here?
I would feel that there is a need to ensure that at least for these 2 years, the FRBM Act is relaxed, and we can relook at that maybe from financial year 22-23, if by then things have normalized. But I think for financial year 2021 and 21-22, clearly the need will be not to be constrained by artificial limits of the FRBM Act, which are just not feasible in the current environment. So I would feel at least for these 2 years, one should defer the FRBM provisions and maybe relook at that once we come to financial year 22-23 and onwards.
a kind of a feeling that there are some special sections of the Act, whether it's ATJJAA or whether it is the allowances for health insurance, right? Should we actually, you know, enable that? That's another way of giving an indirect, you know, tax concession, but promoting, you know, health insurance and also promoting employment. So what do you feel that the government could do in these two areas?
Right. So I think both are very, very valid points, especially so far as the ATJJAA is concerned for employment generation. I would feel that the limit certainly needs to be enhanced from the current 25,000 to at least rupees 1 lakh per month. The need of the hour today is to try and promote employment generation. And in fact, we must move up the value chain. And that's where we feel that the limit of 25,000 is just too low. And we should encourage more jobs being created at that level. And therefore, I do feel that the limit enhancement is something that is immediately called for. In terms of health insurance, this whole COVID environment over the last 10 months has shown how critical it is for people to increasingly see the benefits of health insurance and coverage. I do feel that currently the kind of enlightenment amongst various citizens to go in for health insurance is also at its peak. And at this point of time, therefore, giving that further fillip to the health insurance sector might be extremely helpful. That also eases the burden from the government standpoint over a period of time, because as a country, we do not have so many social security measures like many other countries have, and the affordability also for the government is a challenge. So I would feel there, removal of some of the artificial limits or at least significantly enhancing them would be extremely beneficial. And expanding them to include even certain family members without artificial limits, which sometimes are very, very too small to accommodate family members, would go a long way in helping the economy as a whole to be more protected, stable, and of course, take care of any such future event that could happen. Hopefully, fingers crossed, we don't need to ever use the health insurances. But certainly, I think the habit, the encouragement to citizens to try and maximize use of health insurance benefit is something that would go a long way in helping the citizens in securing themselves against future such events.
Thank you, Mr. Saita, for that excellent, set of views, your three expectations from the budget, stimulating demand, focusing on infrastructure and looking at innovation, your suggestions on the tax things, making it predictable, stable and easy to actually implement so that it acts as a incentive rather than a disincentive for people to invest in India. And your focus on the whole area of the fiscal, the FRBM Act and the need to look at a medium to long-term, and medium-term approach to that, as well as the various suggestions on the tax rates and the simplification. You being an expert in this area, you actually made a lot of suggestions there, which we hope that the viewers will also understand and the government will take into consideration. Thank you very much for your time. Thank you for your leadership of this work within FICCI. And, all eyes are on Feb 1, and hopefully the country will truly applaud the finance minister for one of the most historic budgets of this time. So thank you very much.
Indeed, thank you so much. Let's all hope it is a landmark budget and the opportunity is used well for the growth of the economy and for the benefit of all. Thank you.
Thank you.